are going to take a diesel train into service. First, collect the controls. The brake handle, the reversing lever, the door keys, and the control circuit switch key. These are kept in a satchel when not in use. The satchels are stored in their proper place in the depot and issued to drivers when required. Make sure that there are no not-to-be-moved boards or red flags on the train before you get in. First, remove the detonator canister from behind the driving seat and check that the seal around the top is intact. The red flag is also in the canister. Now check that the handbrake is full on and the ratchet down. You may have to open the back of the destination indicator in order to see properly when you set it. Insert the control circuit key and turn it on. At the same time, switch on the lights for the two indicators. If there is less than 75 pounds of air in the control system, or if the engines are cold, you should start them from outside. Take the door keys with you and inspect the train as you walk around. As this train has been standing all night, it has to be fully prepared. On arriving at the first engine, check the fuel level in the tanks. Then pull the throttle full out and press the start button, in this case, number 2 engine. Release the button immediately the engine starts. If it is cold, it may not fire for quite a few moments. When it does fire, ease the throttle in and out gently, but do not race the engine. As the engine runs, it is also building up air pressure for the control system because it is driving the air compressor. The throttle must be held open until the engine will run at idling speed. Release it gently and see if the engine does continue to run. Walk round to the other side of the train and keep a lookout for any defects, checking the classification and destination indicators as you go. Start the second engine in the same way as the first. It should only be necessary to use the hand throttle to overcome the coldness of the engine and don't race it. Now that the two engines are running, you should carry on to the rear cab. Check the detonator canister. There should be one in each cab. You must remember to release the rear handbrake because a great deal of damage will be done to wheel tires if these trains are driven with a handbrake on. rear destination indicator must correspond with the front one, and its light must be switched off. Also check that the Perspex cover of the dead man's isolating valve is intact. Those engines must now be stopped. On some cars, until the reversing lever is in place and a direction of travel selected, the engines can only be stopped from the outside. There is a carriage heater fuel tank gauge on some trains which must be checked as you pass. The compressor, driven by the engine, has now raised the air pressure to 75 pounds, the minimum satisfactory working pressure for the cab controls. First, fit the brake handle. The reversing lever controls the position of the dogs in the final drives. As you select it forward direction, a piston pushed the dogs into mesh in number one final drive. Like this. In number two drive, the dogs moved over, but did not mesh as the teeth were not opposite each other. That is why the air light has not come on. It will only light when both drives are in mesh and the air pressure is at least 75 pounds. As soon as the engine starts, the oil drag will turn the dogs sufficiently to mesh. Now depress the throttle to engage the dead man's device. Move the throttle to notch 2. This causes the throttle motor to open the fuel rack a little. To start the engines, press the start buttons one at a time. Now, number two button. There, the air light came up as well. Now return the throttle to the idling position. The engines have also been driving the exhauster of the brake system and building up the vacuum reservoir. On the right is the release pipe reading, and on the left, the train pipe reading. Next, test the brake and dead man systems. Release the brake until 21 inches is registered on the train pipe. Then return the brake to the lap position. Let go of the throttle handle and check that the indicator light goes out. After 5 seconds, the vacuum is destroyed. So, applying the brakes. Now, release the handbrake. The train is now ready to move. While awaiting the guard signal, release the brake a little until about 15 inches is registered. That is sufficient to hold the train. Check, finally, that the air pressure has built up to 95 pounds per square inch, that the dead man's indicator light is on, and that the engine and air lights are on. On receiving the two buzzes, select first gear and then release the brakes altogether. When the gearbox was in neutral, heavy parts were revolving inside. A sectioned gearbox shows what happens in slow motion. First gear is selected by tightening the nearest brake band, which slows and stops the nearest drum. As this takes time to happen, you must pause after selecting gear before you accelerate. Under the train, the fluid flywheel and freewheel take up the drive. Engine power is now being transmitted through the gearbox to the carbon shaft, and so to the final drive in the road wheels.